Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Carrying on with the issues of the chapter, issue number 11, the importance to teach step by step. And this is taken from the instructions which the Prophet ﷺ gave to Mu'adh ibn Jabal to teach them about the Tawheed first, the basic belief, and then move on to teaching them about the Salah and then the Zakah. Issue number 12, the most important issues are to be explained first. Again, this is taken from the Hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Issue number 13, how to spend zakah. And this is taken from his statement, تُؤْخَذُ مِنْ أَغْنِيَائِهِمْ فَتُرَدُّ عَلَىٰ فُقَرَائِهِمْ, taken from their rich and given to their poor. Issue number 14, that the teacher should clear up any misunderstandings which the student may have. And this is taken from his statement when he tells Mu'adh that the zakah is taken from their rich and given to their poor. So he's making clear that zakah is not taken from everybody in the community, and it is only taken from the rich, who have the minimum nisab. Issue number 15, that you are not allowed to take the best type of wealth from the people for the zakah money. This is from the statement of the Prophet, فَإِيَّاكَ وَكَرَائِمَ أَمْوَالِهِمْ, then be aware of taking the best type of property. Issue number 16, the person who is oppressed, his dua is answered, so you have to be aware of it. This is taken from his statement, وَاتَّقِي دَعْوَةَ الْمَظْلُومِ, and beware of the dua of the one who has been oppressed. The generality of this hadith means that even if a kafir who is oppressed makes a dua, then this dua is accepted. Issue number 17, we're informed that there is no barrier between the supplication of the one who is oppressed and Allah. This is taken from his statement, فَإِنَّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ حِجَابٌ, there is no hijab or barrier between this da'wah and Allah. And we take from this that the teacher, when he's teaching the students and encouraging them to do good deeds, must use both tactics to encourage the person to do good and also words which will scare him away from doing evil deeds. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that there is no barrier between the dua of the mazloom and Allah. So this would scare the person into not oppressing other people. Because if you just said, don't oppress other people, then they may not take it seriously. But if you tell them that between the oppressed person's dua and Allah there is no hijab, then this will be far more effective on the listener. So the idea is to use words which encourage and cause fear in the heart. So this balance needs to be struck. Issue number 18. From the evidences of Tawheed is that which afflicts the best of the messengers and the best of those who are close to Allah from difficulties of life and hunger and disease and epidemics. What seems apparent from this point is that the Shaykh is referring to the story of Khaybar when he sent Ali ibn Abi Talib, because during this time there was much hunger suffered by the companions to the point that they had to eat the meat of the donkey and garlic. As for the disease which he talks about, or the epidemic, then this is what took place during the Khilafah of Ali ibn Abi Talib. So the point is that how is all of this an evidence of Tawheed? Because if you are patient with all of these hardship, then this is evidence that you are sincere to Allah Jalla wa'ala. Because it is only because of your Tawheed that you are patient, and you are hoping in reward for Allah. And this is clear evidence that you have Tawheed. Issue number 19. That the Prophet's saying, I shall give the flag. And this statement is from the signs of prophethood. And the reason is because what he said actually occurred. And he was speaking about the future. And we know that Ali ibn Abi Talib loves Allah and the Messenger, and Allah and the Messenger love him. Issue number 20. Applying his spit to the eyes of Ali radiallahu anhu and how he was cured of his ailment is another sign of prophethood. This is because if you normally spit on somebody's eyes, it will not make the pain go away if they are suffering a pain. So we see that this is another one of those miracles given to the prophets. Issue number 21, the virtue of Ali radiallahu anhu. And this is obvious because from the hadith we come to know that Ali radiallahu anhu loves Allah and the Messenger, and Allah and the Messenger love him. So in this there is plenty of virtue. Issue number 22, the virtue of the companions, that they kept speculating among themselves throughout the night who will be given the flag. And this actually occupied them rather than the good news that they will be victorious in a conquest. And so from this it becomes known that the companions were not happy to be just minimum Muslims, Rather, they wanted to be the special chosen ones who were brought close to Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is why it occupied their minds and they kept speaking about it throughout the night. And the fact that the Prophet told them that they will be enjoying a great conquest did not bother them too much. They were far more interested in being one of those who are chosen by Allah and the Messenger. And this is how we should all be, always seeking to gain closeness to Allah Jalla wa Ala, and never being happy just to be a minimum Muslim who just prays his salah and does his fasting in Ramadan and performs his hajj and pays his zakah. But rather we need to strive to increase our ranks with Allah Jalla wa Ala. And in the companions you have a good example of how to do this. Issue number 23, illustrating the faith in Al-Qadr, or predestination, that whatever is going to happen will occur to the one it is destined to happen, and whoever strives for a certain achievement will not attain it if it is not written for him. And we take this because the companions spoke all night long about who will be given the flag, and they all were seeking it. And in the morning they went to the Prophet ﷺ, all of them hoping that they will be the one given the flag. And the one person who did not attend was Ali ibn Abi Talib, because he was suffering an ailment in the eye. And yet we find he was the one to be given the flag. So the point is, you will be given your fair share of this world, whether you seek it or not, come what may. So you could find many people striving to attain the riches of this world, and they would not attain except what has already been written for them. And this is what Qadr is all about. And in this hadith, you have a good illustration of how it works. Issue number 24, the manner of the Prophet's advice to Ali, when he said, "Move forward with ease and gentleness." So we find in this advice, the Prophet ordered him not to hasten and hurry and take your time. And this is from the mannerisms of the Muslim, is that he is calm, collected and takes his time. And the Prophet ﷺ also said, "Al-anatu min Allah wal-ajalatu min ash-shaytan." Taking your time is from Allah and hastening is from shaytan. Issue number 25, calling to al-Islam before fighting. And this is taken from his statement when he told Ali ibn Abi Talib, "Hatta tanzila bisahatihim thumma ad'uhum ila al-Islam." Until you reach their area, call them to al-Islam. So he did not tell him to fight them straight away, but rather firstly you have to call to al-Islam. Issue number 26, that it is legislated to fight those who were previously called to Islam but rejected it. Of course, this means you fight them as long as they do not pay the jizya. As for if they pay the jizya and live under Islamic law, then you are not allowed to fight them. So basically, we do not fight them for the sake of fighting them, but rather as long as the word of Allah Jalla wa Ala is highest and uppermost in the land, then there is no need to fight. Issue number 27, giving da'wah with wisdom, due to the Prophet saying, "أخبرهم بما يجب عليهم من حق الله تعالى فيه." And inform them what is obligatory upon them from the rights of Allah in Islam. And so from the hikmah or wisdom is that, firstly you order them to accept Islam, and then thereafter you inform them what are the obligations and rights which Allah Jalla wa Ala has over them. And so just calling to Islam is not good enough, but rather you have to take care of the people who enter Islam and teach them well, so that they apply Islam in their lives and they do not apostate from the religion. Issue number 28, recognizing the duty owed to Allah in al-Islam. And this is taken from his statement when he tells him and inform them the rights of Allah in Islam. Issue number 29, the reward of a person by whose hand a man is guided from kufr to al-Islam. And this is taken from the statement of the Prophet, "لَأَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ رَجُلًا وَاحِدًا خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمُرِ النَّعْمِ." That Allah should guide one man through you is better than red camels. And in those days, of course, red camels were considered to be the best type of wealth. So basically, we can extend the argument and say that a person should be guided through you is better for you than the best type of wealth in your day and age. Some ulama interpreted this to be that it is better for you than to give charity with the red camels. And this interpretation is not apparent from the hadith. What is apparent from the hadith is that red camels should come to you and you should own them. And issue number 30, to swear an oath when giving a fatwa. And this is taken from the statement of the Prophet, "فَوَاللَّهِ لَأَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ." By Allah, that Allah should guide up until the end of it. So we find that the Prophet ﷺ took an oath, yet he was not asked to take an oath. So why did he therefore take an oath? Because the issue which he is speaking about is extremely important, and you're allowed to take an oath for issues which are extremely important. However, the general rule about taking an oath is that it should not be done except for a real benefit. And if you are giving a fatwa, then you should not swear an oath except for a real benefit, because the person hearing you might think that you might be in doubt. This is why you are swearing an oath. And so we find that we are allowed to swear an oath on three occasions. Number one, if the person you are speaking to is in some kind of doubt and you want to remove his doubt by taking an oath. Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah Yunus, Ayah 53, وَيَسْتَنْبِئُونَكَ أَحَقٌ هُوَ قُلْ إِي وَرَبِّي إِنَّهُ لَحَقٌ وَمَا أَنْتُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ. They ask you, is this the truth? Say, by Allah, this is the truth and you cannot escape. So we find that these people were in doubt as to whether Al-Islam is the truth. Or you can also swear if the person you're speaking to does not believe something you are saying. As in Surah At-Taghabun, Ayah number 7, زَعَمَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَلَّنْ يُبْعَثُوا قُلْ بَلَى وَرَبِّي لَتُبْعَثُنَّ. Those people who made kufr, they claim that they will not be resurrected. Say, rather, by my Lord, you will be resurrected. And the third place is when you are stressing something extremely important. As in the hadith in the Sahih, فَوَاللَّهِ لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى أَكُونَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ وَالِدِهِ وَوَلَدِهِ. By Allah, one of you will not believe until I am more beloved to him than his father and his children. So these are three cases when you are not asked to swear. As for if somebody asks you to swear because maybe he doesn't believe you, then in this case you should swear an oath in order to make the other person believe you. So this is the end of chapter 5. Let's take some review questions. Question number 1. We know that you have to call the people to Allah upon basira, which is insight. And we said that you have to have knowledge of three things. What are they? Question number 2. The Prophet called and ordered his people to call to one thing alone. What is this, and what is the evidence from this chapter which proves this point? Question number 3. The hadith of Ali ibn Abi Talib given the flag proves a point about the qadr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Explain it. We'll now move on to chapter number 6. And this is titled An Explanation of Tawheed and the Shahada of La ilaha illallah. So this chapter is about giving the tafsir of Tawheed. The word tafsir in Arabic means to make something clear. And as for the word at-tawheed, then when this word at-tawheed is used in this book of Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, then it is referring to tawheed al-uluhiyya, the tawheed that only Allah has the right to be worshipped. It does not refer to tawheed al-rububiyya, because there is no difference of opinion on this issue. And so we find up to now the Shaykh has informed us about the obligation of having tawheed, the virtue of tawheed, and the necessity to call people to a tawheed. And now he moves on to explaining what tawheed is. And so the first evidence, taken from Surah Al-Isra, Ayah 57, and of course, as always, this has to be memorized. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ يَبْتَغُونَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمُ الْوَسِيلَةَ أَيُّهُمْ أَقْرَبُ وَيَرْجُونَ رَحْمَتَهُ وَيَخَافُونَ عَذَابَهُ إِنَّ عَذَابَ رَبِّكَ كَانَ مَحْذُورًا. And those whom they call upon are only desiring for themselves a means to access their Lord, meaning to gain closeness to their Lord. Which of them would be the nearest? And they hope for his mercy and they fear his torment. Verily the torment of your Lord is something to be feared. So in this ayah, Allah Jalla wa'ala is telling us that these people who make shirk with Allah and they call upon besides Allah, then these gods, they themselves are desiring a closeness to Allah. So if people call upon Isa alayhi salam, or Maryam alayhi salam, or Uzair, or some malaika, then these are all slaves of Allah Jalla wa'ala who themselves are seeking a closeness to him. So how do they deserve to be worshipped? Is this anything but foolishness? And so this ayah applies to those people who are worshipped besides Allah Jalla wa'ala, for whom it is possible to seek a nearness to Allah. So this could be the pious people and the prophets or angels and the like. It does not include if people are worshipping stones or statues. And Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah Fatir, Ayah 13 and 14, وَالَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ لَا يَمْلِكُونَ مِن قِطْمِيرٍ. And those whom they invoke upon besides Allah do not even own the membrane of a date stone. إِن تَدْعُوهُمْ لَا يَسْمَعُوا دُعَاءَكُمْ وَلَوْ سَمِعُوا مَا اسْتَجَابُوا لَكُمْ وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يَكْفَرُونَ بِشِرْكِكُمْ وَلَا يُنَبِّئُكَ مِثْلُ خَبِيرٍ. And if you call upon them, they will not hear you. And if they could hear you, they will not be able to answer your call. And on يوم القيامة, they will disown your worship of them, and nobody can inform you about this except the one who knows everything. The ayah mentions the word al-wasila, which means a means. So a means which will take you closer to Allah. So when Allah Jalla wa'ala talks about a wasila or a means to gain close to Him, then this means acts of worship which are legislated in al-Islam, not acts of worship which are innovated. And it is not as the Sufis claim that the wasila could be all types of innovated acts of worship which they do. No, the wasila has to be something which is laid down by Allah Jalla wa'ala. So the question is, why did the Shaykh include this ayah under this chapter? It is because at-tawheed includes that you should be free from shirk, such that you do not call upon anyone other than Allah, neither an angel, nor a prophet, nor a saint. Because angels, prophets and saints, they themselves are seeking a means of closeness to Allah and are competing amongst themselves who can be closer to Allah. And they are hoping for the mercy of Allah and fearing His punishment. So in fact, this ayah is giving us one of the conditions for your shahada of La ilaha illallah to be correct, which is that you must make kufr in worshipping anything besides Allah. So to become a Muslim for Allah, you have to become a kafir in anything which is worshipped other than Allah. The second evidence from Surah Az-Zukhruf, ayah 26 to 28, وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ وَقَوْمِهِ إِنَّنِي بَرَاءٌ مِّمَّا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي فَإِنَّهُ سَيَهْدِينَ وَجَعَلَهَا كَلِمَةً بَاقِيَةً فِي عَقِبِهِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. And when Ibrahim said to his father and his people, I am free of what you worship, but the one who has created me, verily he will guide me. And he, meaning Allah, made it, meaning the kalima of La ilaha illallah, a lasting word among his offspring that they may turn back, meaning to say repent to Allah Jalla wa'ala. So in these ayat we find that Ibrahim has declared to his father and his people that he is free from that which they worship. In other words, he has made kufr in what they are worshipping. And the people of Ibrahim alayhi salam were worshipping their idols. And from them there were those who worshipped the sun and the moon and the stars. But Ibrahim doesn't just leave it there that he is free from that which they are worshipping. So firstly, he has negated the false gods. And then afterwards he has to affirm the true God, which is Allah. This is why he said, but the one who has created me, verily he will guide me. So we find that your tawheed cannot be complete except with two things, negation and affirmation. Or you can say kufr and iman. This makes your tawheed, kufr in the false gods and iman in the true God. One without the other is not tawheed. And Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 256, فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى لَا انْفِصَامَ لَهَا. Whoever makes kufr in taghut, which are the false gods, and makes iman in Allah, then he has held onto the most firm handle which will not split. And unfortunately, we find in Muslim countries, people who are performing their salah, their sawm and their hajj, but along with this, they are going to the graves and asking the pious dead people to intercede for them with Allah Jalla wa'ala. So these people have not implemented tawheed in their lives. And this is a crucial point because many Muslims have become entangled in this fitna. And awareness and knowledge must be raised and propagated amongst these people. And we find in the ayah that Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam says, but the one who has created me. He does not say, but Allah. Why is this? He emphasizes on the point that Allah has created him because surely the one who creates you is worthy of worship. So he's giving the reason why he worships Allah. And secondly, he's pointing out that these idols you are worshipping have not created you. So how do they deserve to be worshipped? They themselves are created. So in fact, we find that he is giving the justification for worshipping Allah Jalla wa'ala in that he is the creator. So if the rububiyyah belongs to him, then so must the uluhiyyah. And so this statement of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam is considered as eloquent, or eloquence in the language, which is balagha, in that he is using few words which convey much meaning. And this is the essence of eloquence in the language. So if you worship Allah and someone other than Allah, then you are not a muwahhid. The point is that you have to be worshipping Allah and Allah alone. The next evidence from Surah At-Tawbah, Ayah 31, Allah says, اتخذوا أحبارهم ورهبانهم أربابا من دون الله. They, meaning the Jews and Christians, took their rabbis and their monks as lords besides Allah. So how did the Jews and Christians take these priests or their scholars and their monks as lords besides Allah? This is because their priests and monks ordered them to do things which Allah forbade them to do. And so they took the words of their leaders and gave them precedence over and above the laws of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And they obeyed them in what is disobedience to Allah. And the ayah goes on, والمسيح ابن مريم, and المسيح, the son of Maryam. This is as the Christians say that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is divine. And the ayah goes on, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا إِلَهٌ وَاحِدًا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوْ سُبْحَانَهُ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. And they were not ordered except to worship one God. There is no one worthy of worship except Him. May He be far removed above what they associate partners with Him. So again, we find this idea of worshipping Allah alone and having kufr in everything which is worshipped besides Allah. Often there is a hadith of Adi ibn Abi Hatib, which explains to us that the Prophet ﷺ told him that the Jews and the Christians obeyed their rabbis and their priests and their monks in what is disobedience to Allah Jalla wa'ala. Certainly this is true, however the hadith in terms of its isnad is da'if or weak. And we find from this ayah that if you obey anyone in what is disobedience to Allah, then you have taken that person as a god besides Allah Jalla wa'ala, because you have put him in the same status as Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ ordered his ummah to obey the ruler in all cases except in that which is disobedience to Allah Jalla wa'ala. As he says in the authentic hadith, إِنَّمَا الطَّاعَةُ فِي الْمَعْرُوفِ, that obedience is only in that which is ma'roof or legislated in the sharia, meaning those things which do not directly oppose the laws of Allah Jalla wa'ala. So if somebody orders you not to pray, for example, then there is no obedience in this. The next piece of evidence from Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 165, he says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And of mankind are some who take for worship others besides Allah as rivals to Allah. They love them as they would love Allah. But those who believe love Allah more than anything else. So some ulama have said that this ayah means that they take their asnam, their idols, and they would love them as equal to their love of Allah. So in other words, in their heart there is an equal love for Allah and for their idols equally. And some ulama have said that this means that they love their idols just as the believers love Allah. But the context of this ayah indicates that the first opinion is the correct opinion. And then he says that those who believe love Allah more than anything else. Meaning to say, they are more severe in their love of Allah than these mushrikeen are in their love to Allah Jalla wa'ala. This is because the love of the believers is purely for Allah Jalla wa'ala. As for the love of the mushrikeen, they love Allah but they commit shirk in their love for Allah, in that they love their asnam equally. And the second opinion in this is that those who believe love Allah more than the mushrikeen love their idols. So here we find Allah is rebuking those who love their asnam just as they would love Allah Jalla wa'ala, or equal amount. So what about the person who loves his asnam and does not have any love for Allah Jalla wa'ala? Then this is even worse. And this is where you can find some people who love their pious ones more than Allah Jalla wa'ala. And you would find them swearing and taking an oath by their awliya or their pious people. And you could find some people coming to Al-Madinah and they think that visiting the grave of the Prophet is more virtuous than visiting the Kaaba, because they love the Prophet ﷺ as they would love Allah, or perhaps even more so. And this is shirk, because we could not love the Prophet except if it was due to the fact that we love Allah Jalla wa'ala. So his love comes first. So you find that in this ayah, there is a great fitna for those people who take other pious saints and love them equally as they would love Allah Azza wa Jal. And this shirk in love does not have to be always necessarily pertaining to other people. It could be material objects of this world. Like the Prophet ﷺ spoke about the slave of the dinar and dirham. because this person loves the dinar and dirham as he would love Allah Jalla wa Ala. So you find in many people, if you were to look into their hearts, there would be love for the materialistic pleasures of this world to the same magnitude of their love for Allah, or perhaps even more so. Wallahu al-musta'an. And so people like these need to think about why they have been created. They have been created to worship Allah Jalla wa Ala, and they have been created to move on to the next world, and that this life is merely a passageway, and you're not going to stay in this life for very long. So don't have your heart attached to it. It doesn't make any sense. And Shaykh Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said that every movement of yours is based around love. You would not make a movement except that you are doing it for something which you love, even if it be a morsel of food which you eat. So we find that love is the basis for all types of movements. Hence, making shirk with Allah Jalla wa Ala in love is one of the types of shirk. And love can be divided into three types. Number one, love for the sake of Allah. And this is that you love something because Allah loves it. So you love your fellow Muslim brothers because Allah loves them. You love the Prophet because Allah loves him. And this is from your tawheed, because only people who have tawheed love for the sake of Allah. The second type is the natural love. A person may love his family and friends. And this type of love should not be given precedence over and above the love for the sake of Allah, meaning the first category. And this type of love does not negate the first category, which is love for the sake of Allah. As the Prophet ﷺ in the Sahih was asked, "Who is the most beloved person to you?" And he replied, "Aisha." Then he was asked, "Then who from the men?" And he replied, "Her father." So this is the natural love between people. And from this also is the love for your food and drink and clothing. The third type is love with Allah. And this is what the ayah is talking about, that you love something just as much as you would love Allah, or even worse, more than you love Allah. Such that if the love of Allah collides with your love of something else, then you would give the love of that something else precedence over and above the love of Allah. So in this case, we would say that you have associated partners with Allah Jalla wa Ala. And the proof is in the ayah, because Allah says that from mankind are those who take partners besides Allah. The Arabic word is andad, plural of nid, which means a rival or a peer or an equal. Then the next evidence which he quotes in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man qala la ilaha illallah wa kafara bima yu'badu min dunillahi haruma maluhu wa damuhu wa hisabuhu 'ala Allah." Whoever says la ilaha illallah and then makes kufr in that which is worshipped besides Allah, then his wealth and his blood are haram, meaning cannot be taken, and his accounting is on Allah Jalla wa Ala. So again, this hadith is proving what the Shaykh wants to prove, is that in order to have tawheed, not only must you believe in Allah Jalla wa Ala and worship him alone, but you necessarily must make kufr in that which is worshipped besides Allah. So we find therefore that the Christians have made shirk because they worship Isa alayhi salam. So we find that Isa alayhi salam is worshipped besides Allah, and the hadith says that we have to make kufr in that which is worshipped besides Allah. Does this mean we make kufr in Isa alayhi salam? No, of course not. A Muslim cannot be a Muslim until he believes that Isa alayhi salam is a slave and messenger of Allah, and that he is the word, which is kun, which Allah threw to Maryam, and a spirit created from Allah, as we mentioned in the hadith before. But rather, what we mean when we say make kufr in that which is worship besides Allah is that you make kufr in his worship, so you do not worship him besides Allah. As for believing in him as being a messenger and a slave, then of course this is wajib. So the key thing to note is that when you say la ilaha illallah, then we need to understand this correctly. Because when you say la ilaha, there is no God, then this means you are making kufr on that which is worshipped besides Allah, meaning in their worship. So in order to become a Muslim, you have to become a kafir in the correct context. If somebody was to say la ilaha illallah and then at the same time believe that the Yahud and Nasara are upon the correct religion, then this person is not a Muslim despite his shahada. Or if somebody thinks that all these religions are different thoughts or schools of thoughts and that you can pick whichever one you want, then this person is not a Muslim. This is why it is not permissible to say that Islam is a thought. It is not a thought, it is a deen, which is a religion and also a way of life, whether it be ritual, social, political, or military. Then the Shaykh moves on to the issues of the chapter, and he doesn't number these points, he just speaks about it continuously. So he says that this chapter contains the greatest and most important of the issues, which is the explanation of At-Tawheed and the explanation of the Shahada and the clarification of it. So this is, as we have stated before, that Tawheed cannot be complete except with two matters: to negate any other god which is worshipped besides Allah, basically to make kufr in that worship, and then secondly, to affirm the fact that Allah is the one who has the right to be worshipped. And so one without the other is no good. If you just say that Allah has the right to be worshipped, that's no good. And if you say that there is no god which has the right to be worshipped, that is no good either. Then the Shaykh goes on, and from the matters which make clear the explanation of the Tawheed and the Shahada is the ayah from Surah Al-Isra. It is a clear rejection to the polytheists who supplicate the righteous ones, and the ayah makes it clear that this is major shirk. The ayah which the Shaykh is talking about is from Surah Al-Isra, number 57, and this is of course the evidence which you should have memorized, and we find therefore that this is major shirk, because dua is worship. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ ادْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبَ لَكُمْ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِرِينَ. And your Lord said, make dua to me, I will answer you. Verily those who are too proud to worship me will enter the fire humiliated. So you find that first he mentions dua, and then in the second part of the ayah he mentions ibadah, which basically means that dua is ibadah. So in the ayah, Allah Jalla wa Ala is using these two words interchangeably. And if you use two words interchangeably, it means that they are the same thing. And you will remember that before we divided dua up into two categories, dua al-ibadah and dua al-mas'ala. So this idea of calling upon the creation can be divided up into three categories. The first one is that it is permissible. And this is when you call upon another creation to help you with something which he is able to do. And this is as the Prophet ﷺ said when he was talking about the rights Muslims have over the other. He said, وَإِذَا دَعَاكَ فَأَجِبْهُ. And when he calls you, then answer him. So you're allowed to call upon other people for help and assistance if it is about something which they are able to do or potentially able to do. The second type is when you call upon the creation to do something which he is not able to do, and only Allah is able to do it. For example, you ask him to forgive your sins, or you ask him to send down rain, or anything of that sort, then this is shirk akbar, the greatest shirk, which takes you out of the fold of Islam. And you have taken with Allah Jalla wa Ala rivals. So people might go to a grave of a saint and they might say, Ya Fulan, O so and so, please make my wife give birth to a son, or anything of this kind of nature, which happens all too often, then this sort of thing only Allah Jalla wa Ala is capable of doing. And so if you were to ask another creation for this type of thing, then you have put that creation in the place of Allah Jalla wa Ala, or certainly on the status of Allah. And this is the whole essence of shirk, when you put somebody other than Allah on the same status as Allah. The third type of calling another creation is when you call a creation and this creation or person is dead, then we say this is also shirk akbar, the greatest form of shirk. And the reason we say this is because the only reason this person is calling upon this dead person is because he believes that this dead person has the ability to affect the creation somehow. Because if you think about it, otherwise he would not be calling upon this dead person. So again, this is similar to the second category, is that you are calling upon someone and asking him to do something which only Allah is able to do. So the second and third categories are shirk akbar, taking you out of the fold of Islam, and the first category is permissible to do. Entering into this third category, of course, is when you go to the dead people and ask them to intercede for you with Allah Jalla wa Ala. Then the Shaykh goes on and says also the verse in Surah Al-Bara'ah, which is the same as Surah At-Tawbah, clearly shows that the people of the book took their priests and their rabbis and their monks as lords besides Allah. And again, we have quoted this ayah in the chapter. And this type of shirk is the shirk at-ta'a, the shirk of obedience. And this is where you give the laws of someone else precedence over the laws of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And Allah says in Surah Ash-Shura, ayah number 10, وما اختلفتم فيه من شيء فحكمه إلى الله. And whenever you differ about something, then the ruling is to Allah. Meaning Allah will decide the affair between you. So you have to judge in accordance with what He has revealed. Likewise in Surah Al-Qasas, Ayah 70, لَهُ الْحُكْمُ وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ To Him belong the judgment and to Him you will return. And we'll discuss more about obeying the scholars and rulers when they make halal what Allah has made haram or make haram what Allah has made halal, because that chapter is coming up. And then the Shaykh goes on, and from the matters which make Tawheed clear is the statement of Ibrahim alayhi salam, إِنَّنِي بَرَاءٌ مِّمَّا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا الَّذِي فَطَرَنِي from Surah Az-Zukhruf, Ayah 26. Verily, I am free of what you're worshipping, but the one who has created me. And so this statement of Ibrahim, Allah Jalla wa Ala made it as an explanation of the testimony of faith, La ilaha illallah, because he goes on to say, وَجَعَلَهَا كَلِمَةً بَاقِيَةً فِي عَقِبِهِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ And he made it an everlasting word among his offspring that they may turn back to Allah. So if you ponder over this, Allah Jalla wa Ala is using the fact that Ibrahim disassociated himself from shirk, and Allah Jalla wa Ala uses this as the meaning of La ilaha illallah, to be free of shirk. So we can say that saying La ilaha illallah actually means that you're saying that you are free from shirk. Then the Shaykh goes on, and from the matters is the ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, which talks about the kuffar, and Allah Jalla wa Ala says, and this is ayah 167, وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا لَوْ أَنَّ لَنَا كَرَّةً فَنَتَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُمْ كَمَا تَبَرَّؤُوا مِنَّا كَذَلِكَ يُرِيهِمُ اللَّهُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ حَسَرَاتٍ عَلَيْهِمْ وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنَ النَّارِ And those who followed will say, if only we had one more chance to return to the world, we would disown them as they disowned us. Thus will Allah show them their deeds as a means of grief for them, and they will never leave the fire. So here Allah Jalla wa Ala is informing us that these false gods which these mushrikeen used to worship will disown the worship, and they will be free of the mushrikeen. And so these mushrikeen who used to worship these false gods would say, if only we had one more chance to go back to the world, we would be free of these false gods, just as today, meaning on Yawm Al-Qiyamah, these false gods have disowned us and have become free from us. And then he says, thus will Allah show them their deeds, meaning their evil deeds and their false worship, as a means of grief for them, because now they know that they cannot make amends. And he says that they will never leave the fire. So this is the punishment of all of the kuffar. And then the Shaykh goes on that the mushrikeen love their false gods just as they love Allah. But their love for Allah, therefore, is not good enough, because your love has to be purely for Allah Jalla wa Ala, and you're not allowed to share in this love with anyone, because this is also a type of shirk, your shirk in your love. Even the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, we are not allowed to love him as much as we love Allah Jalla wa Ala, because if the Prophet was not in fact a messenger, then it would not be obligatory to obey him, and we only love the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam for the sake of Allah. It is perfectly permissible for a person to love other people, like his family members, because that is natural, as long as he does not make this love at the same level as the love of Allah. The Shaykh says, then how about the one who loves the false deities more than he loves Allah? And how about the one who loves his false deity and he has no love for Allah? So therefore we can divide all of this up into four categories. Number one, the person who loves Allah more than anything other than Allah. And this is the one who has Tawheed. Number two, the one who loves something other than Allah the same as he loves Allah. So he loves them both equally, and this is shirk. Thirdly, the one who loves something other than Allah more than he loves Allah. And definitely this is even worse, and it is also shirk. And fourthly, the one who loves other than Allah and he does not have any love for Allah in his heart. And this is yet worse, and is the most evil level. And in chapter 31, we will inshallah talk a bit more about the subject of love for Allah. Then the Shaykh goes on and says, and from the matters, meaning the matters making clear the explanation of the Tawheed, is the Prophet's statement when he says that whoever says La ilaha illallah and he makes kufr in that which is worshipped besides Allah, then his wealth and his blood becomes haram, meaning sacred, and his accounting is with Allah. And this is the hadith we quoted, and you should have memorized it. So we find therefore that it is necessary to make kufr in the taghut and have iman in Allah. As he says in the Quran, فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ إِسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى لَانْفِصَامَ لَهَا. Whoever makes kufr in taghut and believes in Allah, then he has held on to the firmest handle which will not split. And so when he says in the hadith that he makes kufr in that which is worshipped other than Allah, then this is the kufr in the actual worship itself. Because if Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is being worshipped by the Christians, it does not mean that you make kufr in Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, but you make kufr in his worship. Otherwise, Muslims accept Isa alayhi salatu wasalam as a messenger of Allah, and it is not permissible to make kufr in him. So we find therefore it is not permissible to say, there is no God but Allah and I do not worship Allat. Allat of course is one of the idols of the mushrikeen. But rather you would have to say that the worship of Lat is not worship with due right. Because somebody could not worship the false gods, but he could still acknowledge that these false gods can be worshipped by other people. So even this acknowledgement is not good enough and will take you out of the fold of Al-Islam. You have to make kufr in all other types of gods. So whoever believes that the religion of the Christians and the Jews is a true religion, then this is the whole essence of kufr, and you have not manifested the tawheed nor the shahada of la ilaha illallah. So your shahada cannot be complete except by making kufr in all other religions. And also in this regard, the Jews and the Christians say that their religion is Abrahamic. They say it is an Abrahamic faith. And this is an absolute lie against Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah jalla wa ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah number 140, أَمْ تَقُولُونَ إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَعِيلَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ وَالْأَسْبَاطَ كَانُوا هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا قُلْ أَأَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ أَمِ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ كَتَمَ شَهَادَةً عِنْدَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. Or are you people saying that Ibrahim and Ismail and Ishaq and Ya'qub and his sons were Jews or Christians? Say, do you know better or does Allah know better? And who is more unjust than he who conceals the testimony from Allah? And Allah is not unaware of what you do. In the ayah, the testimony which he is talking about is the testimony written in the books of the Yahud and the Nasara that the Prophet ﷺ is indeed the final prophet. It's all been prophesied in their own scriptures, but they are hiding it. And Allah tells us that they are hiding it in the Quran in this ayah. Likewise in Surah Ali Imran, ayah number 67, مَا كَانَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ يَهُودِيًّا وَلَا نَصْرَانِيًّا وَلَكِنْ كَانَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Ibrahim was neither a Jew nor Christian, but rather he was a monotheist Muslim, and he was not from the mushrikeen. The Hanif mentioned in this ayah is the one who inclines away from the falsehood and inclines towards the truth. So it is upon you, O listener, akramakallah, not to let yourself be fooled by the Yahud and the Nasara, who claim that Ibrahim alayhi salam was from them. Ibrahim alayhi salam is as far away from the Yahud and Nasara as the sky is from the earth. The Jews and the Christians will claim that they have much in common with al-Islam, and they are only doing this so that the Muslims can give up some parts of their religion, and then they can give up some parts of their religion, so that we can both compromise with each other. And Allah Jalla wa'ala warns us about this in Surah Al-Qalam, ayah number 9, وَدُّوا لَوْ تُدْهِنُوا فَيُدْهِنُونَ. They would love for you to compromise some of your religion, so they would compromise some of their religion. Rather, we say that the Yahud and Nasara have disbelieved and made kufr in Ibrahim and Musa and Isa alayhimus salatu wasalam. Because whoever makes kufr in Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has made kufr in all of the messengers. So after all of this has been discussed, then know that the ulama have given 8 conditions for the testimony of La ilaha illallah to be correct. And they are as follows. Number 1, al-ilm. You have to have knowledge of this shahada. And this is the opposite of al-jahl, ignorance. So we find that you cannot give the shahada without knowledge. Number 2, al-yaqeen, which is certainty. So you must not be in any doubt. Number 3, as-sidq, which is truth. So you must not be lying in this statement of yours. Number 4, al-ikhlas, which means to say you're doing it seeking the pleasure of Allah Jalla wa Ala, or seeking closeness to Him. So you're not doing it for any worldly benefit. Number 5, Al-Qabool, that you accept this testimony. It is the opposite of you rejecting it, because the munafiqeen would make the testimony, but they would actually reject it. Number 6, Al-Inqiyad, which is that you obey and are humble to the laws of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So it is no point in you testifying to the Shahada, but not obeying Allah Jalla wa Ala in all that He commands you to do, and refraining from all which He prohibits you. Number 7, Al-Mahabbah, which is love. So that you have to love Allah Jalla wa Ala and the Messenger, and this is opposite to you hating them. So if you hate Allah and the Messenger, then your testimony is not proper and complete. And number 8, Kufr. You have to make kufr in all that which is worshipped besides Allah, and this is what this chapter has been all about. So these are the 8 conditions which must be fulfilled in order for your testimony of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah to be acceptable. That's the end of the chapter, so let's now take some review questions. Question number 1. The first evidence of this chapter, ayah number 57 from Surah Al-Isra. Why did the Shaykh include this ayah in this chapter? Question number 2. Ayah 165 from Al-Baqarah, which is again one of the evidences in this chapter. It talks about the mushrikeen taking rivals with Allah, and they love them as they would love Allah. There are 2 ways that this verse can be interpreted. Give these 2 interpretations. Question number 3. In talking about this ayah, we divided love into 3 categories. What are they? Question number 4. We spoke about calling upon others besides Allah Jalla wa Ala, and we divided this into 3 categories. What are they? Let us now move on to chapter number 7. And this talks about wearing a ring or a string or anything like that in order to remove any calamity, and that this is from shirk. Before we move on to discussing the evidences, just a quick introductory word. The Shaykh says that this is from shirk. So it means this is not shirk in its entirety, but it is from shirk or part of shirk. And so wearing these necklaces or rings or anything of this sort, like amulets, in order to remove calamities, then this could be either shirk asghar or shirk akbar, depending on the belief of the person wearing them. If he believes that this ring or this bracelet itself has the power to remove calamities, then no doubt this is shirk akbar. If he thinks that it is Allah who will remove the calamity, but wearing this ring is just a means, then this is shirk asghar, the smaller type of shirk. But in any case, it is classified as shirk. But why is it classified as shirk? Because they are saying that this bracelet or ring is a cause, a sabab, to remove their calamity. So anyone who invents his own sabab or his own cause, which Allah Jalla wa Ala has sent down no authority for, and neither is it known through life experience that this is a cause to produce the desired effects, because sometimes you can know through scientific experiments that something is a cause. For example, you can know that medicine is a cause to combat disease. So the point is that this person has ascribed a cause which is not known through the Sharia nor through life experience or scientific research. Then this making up of your own cause is from shirk, because he has made it as a partner with Allah Jalla wa Ala. And again, it's all about giving something other than Allah the status which solely belongs to Allah. So we find that only Allah Jalla wa Ala is authorized to give a cause. This cause can either be from the Sharia, or it could be from his own qadr, which is known through scientific experiment, like medicines which combat disease. This is from the qadr of Allah. So when it comes to this idea of causes, then we have 3 groups. 2 of them are extremists, and 1 is the moderate in the middle. First of all, we have those types of people who negate the asbab, the cause. And so these people negate the wisdom of Allah. These are the Jabariya and also the Asha'ira, who are from the Jabariya also. They say everything happens because of the will of Allah, and it doesn't have a cause. It's just that Allah has willed it, and so it has happened, and that's it. There is no cause. There is no asbab. The second category is on the other extreme. They make up causes which Allah has sent down no authority for, neither in the Sharia nor in the Qadr. And these are the superstitious type of people, and also the Sufiya are well known for this. And then thirdly, we have the middle category. They believe that there is such a thing as a cause and effect, but they do not establish any causes from their own selves. They do not make anything up. They only go along with what Allah has sent down evidence for, either in the Sharia or in the Qadr. And this third category are upon the truth, as it is Allah Jalla wa'ala who creates the cause and that which is caused, meaning the effect of the cause. So if you're ill, then you take medicine. The medicine is the cause for you to become cured. And the effects of this cause, of the medicine, is that you are cured from your illness. And Allah creates the cause and the effects of this cause. So for example, if somebody is ill and you give him ruqya and you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, of course you are believing that it is Allah who is going to produce the healing. But if you believe that Surah Al-Fatiha is the cause to do this, then you would need evidence. Do we have evidence? In this case, yes, we do have evidence. And we already mentioned the hadith about the ruqya, when the detachment of the army performed ruqya on a group of people who did not give them any accommodation. And the Prophet acknowledged this. So how do we know if something is a cause or not? First of all, we can know it through the text of the Sharia. So for example, Allah Jalla wa'ala in Surah Al-Nahl, Ayah 69 says that the honey is a healing for people. And we also know that reciting the Qur'an is a healing. Allah says in Surah Al-Isra, Ayah 82, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. And we have sent down from the Qur'an what is a healing and a mercy for the believers, and it does not increase the transgressors except in loss. The second method is the Qadr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And this is when we know through scientific experiments that something is beneficial. And this is where most modern day medicines come into play. They test out the medicine and they find that it works against certain bacteria and diseases. However, in this category, the medicine needs to have a direct influence on the disease. Because otherwise a person could wear a ring or an amulet and he could say that when I wore this, I was cured of my illness. And so therefore he could go on believing that it is this ring or this bracelet which had an effect or which was a cause. No, we say that the cause needs to be direct. Just because somebody mentally feels himself getting better from his illness is not good enough to make that thing a cause. Because it may work for him, but it might not work for somebody else. So the point about this chapter is that anything which is not a proper sabab or a proper cause, then this falls under shirk, if you believe that it is going to remove some calamity or hardship. And as mentioned before, this can either be shirk akbar or shirk asghar. And also remember the three categories of people when it comes to the cause and effect. Let's take a look at this first evidence from Surah Az-Zumar, Ayah 38. Allah says, قُلْ أَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ أَرَادَنِي اللَّهُ بِضُرٍّ هَلْ هُنَّ كَاشِفَاتُ ضُرِّهِ أَوْ أَرَادَنِي بِرَحْمَةٍ هَلْ هُنَّ مُمْسِكَاتُ رَحْمَتِهِ قُلْ حَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ يَتَوَكَّلُ الْمُتَوَكِّلُونَ. Say, do you see those you are calling besides Allah? If Allah wants to harm me, can these gods remove his harm? Or if he wants to give mercy to me, can these gods withhold his mercy? Say, sufficient is Allah for me. Let those who trust put their trust in him. In this ayah, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمْ, do you see? It actually means, inform me. Just as he says, أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ, do you see the one who belies the deen, which is the religion. So it actually means, inform me of the one who belies the religion. The ayah mentions, تَدْعُونَ, you are making dua to. And remember, dua is of two types, dua al-ibadah and dua al-mas'alah. So you find the mushrikeen are making dua to their idols when they take vows in their name, or when they slaughter in their name, or when they make ruku and sujood to them, then this is all dua al-ibadah. And they're also making dua al-mas'alah because they are in effect asking these idols to remove their harm or to bring about benefit. And of course, mas'alah means when you ask for something or request something. So Allah Jalla wa'ala is saying that if Allah was to harm you or benefit you, then these false gods could not change this affair. So note that in the ayah he says, حَسْبِي Allah, that Allah is sufficient for me. The way that this is put in the Arabic, it means that only Allah is sufficient for me and no one else. And so because only Allah is sufficient for me, he says, let those who trust put their trust in him. So we find that the shahid from this ayah is that the idols and false gods cannot harm nor benefit. And Allah has not made them a cause for harm and benefit. So the Shaykh makes an analogy and extends the ruling on the bracelets and rings which people wear. That these bracelets and rings cannot harm nor benefit, and neither has Allah made them a cause for harm and benefit, just like the idols. As for undertaking the correct means, whether it be a Sharia means or a Qadari means, then this is from tawakkul, is that you rely upon Allah and also you undertake the necessary means to bring about benefit or ward off harm. Let's look at the next evidence. This is the hadith found in Musnad Imam Ahmad, and it is authentic on the authority of Imran ibn Husayn radiallahu anhu. He says, أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ رَأَى رَجُلًا فِي يَدِهِ حَلْقَةٌ مِّن صُفْرٍ فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَا هَذِهِ. That the Prophet ﷺ saw a man, he had a yellow ring on his hand, and so the Prophet asked him, what is this? قَالَ مِنَ الْوَاهِنَةِ. He said, I'm wearing this because I have weakness. فَقَالَ إِنْزَعْهَا فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَزِيدُكَ إِلَّا وَهْنًا فَإِنَّكَ لَوْ مُتَّ وَهِيَ عَلَيْكَ مَا أَفْلَحْتَ أَبَدًا. The Prophet replied, take it off, because it will only increase you in your weakness. For if you were to die and this is on you, then you would never succeed. So we found in the first evidence, which is the ayah, it's speaking about the asnam. And we can take an analogy and extend the ruling to the rings and bracelets. As for this hadith, it is specifically talking about a ring or a bracelet, as we have just heard. And there are many points of benefit that can be taken from this hadith. Firstly, that if you want to forbid the evil, then always ask about the evil that is taking place. Because perhaps you think it is evil, but in reality it is not. So this is why you found the Prophet ﷺ, he wanted to forbid this evil, but first he had to make sure. So he asked him, what is this? And so the man replied, I'm wearing this because of weakness. So in other words, the man made this ring a sabab or a cause to remove his weakness. And so the Prophet ﷺ rebuked this idea, because this man has come with a cause which Allah has sent down no authority for. Secondly, we also learn the obligation of removing the munkar, the evil. This is where the Prophet told him to remove it or take it off. And he did not just leave it at the order. He also justified this order when he said that it will only increase you in weakness. So what does this mean, that it will increase you in weakness? Weakness can be physical and also mental. And what is intended here is the mental weakness, which can also lead to physical weakness. This is because this man is now depending on this ring to heal him. And so therefore he is focused on his illness, that he is weak, and he is repeating this to himself mentally. This ring is most likely to remind him that he is weak. And so if you are kept on reminded that you are weak, then of course this will increase you in your weakness, because how you think psychologically has an effect on your body. Thirdly, we take from this hadith that those asbab or those causes which have not been legislated in the Sharia, and neither are they known through the Qadr of Allah, then they do not benefit people. And fourth, we learn that if you were to die upon this, then you will never succeed. Succeeding in the hereafter is escaping the punishment of the fire and entering Jannah. But is this Shirk Akbar or Asghar? We explained this issue previously, and that it depends on his belief. We also take from this hadith that your actions are judged by the last of your actions. As the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-A'mal bil-Khawatim, your actions are judged in accordance with the last of your actions. So you could be doing righteous deeds all through your life, but right near the end you could do something which involves shirk, and you have ruined it all for yourself. And so this is where the Prophet ﷺ says in this hadith, لَوْ مُتَّ وَهِيَ عَلَيْكَ, if you were to die and this was on you, then you would not succeed, despite the fact that he could be doing righteous deeds all throughout his life. Yet still, he would not succeed. Why? Because his final act was pertaining to shirk. And so we also take that if he was to take it off before his death, then this would not harm him, because this would be seen as repentance. And the one who repents, then it is as if he has no sin on him. Let's move on to the next piece of evidence. On the authority of Uqba ibn Amir radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ تَعَلَّقَ تَمِيمَةً فَلَا أَتَمَّ اللَّهُ لَهُ وَمَنْ تَعَلَّقَ وَدَعَةً فَلَا وَدَعَ اللَّهُ لَهُ. Whoever wears a talisman or an amulet, then may Allah not see his wish fulfilled, meaning his wish for which he is wearing the talisman. And whoever hangs a seashell, then may Allah never give him peace and rest. In this hadith, the word tamima is mentioned. This is normally something which is hung on children to protect them from the evil eye and other kinds of evil effects. This hadith is reported in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, and there is a difference of opinion as to its authenticity, but it is likely to be weak. In another narration, in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, it says, "Man ta'allaqa tamimatan faqad ashrak." Whoever hangs a tamima, which is a talisman or amulet, then he has committed shirk. This narration is also weak. And the next evidence, on the authority of Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, أنه رأى رجلا في يده خيط من الحمى فقطعها وتلا قوله وما يؤمن أكثرهم بالله إلا وهم مشركون. That Hudhayfa saw a man who had a string tied on his hand because he was suffering a fever. So he tore it out and he narrated the statement of Allah in Surah Yusuf, Ayah 106. And most of them believe in Allah but still practice shirk. This narration is also weak. In this last narration, we see that Hudhayfa tore off this string. And this is because if you see an evil, then you need to change it with your hands if you have the authority to do so. As for the ayah which he quoted, then people believe in Allah, but this is Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, but they make kufr in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. And then the Shaykh mentions the issues of this chapter. Number one, the strict forbiddance of wearing rings and strings and the like. And this is taken from the statement of the Prophet when he said to him, "Inza'ha," take it off. فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَزِيدُكَ إِلَّا وَهْنًا. It will only increase you in weakness. فَإِنَّكَ لَوْ مُتَّ وَهِيَ عَلَيْكَ مَا أَفْلَحْتَ أَبَدًا. For if you were to die and it is on you, you would never succeed. So you can see from the nature of the words that this is a severe warning. Issue number two, that if the companion had died wearing such a thing, he would not have succeeded in the hereafter. And in this also there is evidence to the statement of the Sahaba that minor shirk is greater than the major sins. And this is clear from the hadith, because if a Sahabi would not succeed because he committed shirk, then what about the rest of us? And we know from the statement of Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu that he said that I should swear by Allah and lie is more beloved to me than for me to swear by other than Allah whilst saying the truth. This is because swearing by Allah and lying is a sin, but swearing by other than Allah is a type of shirk. So even if it is a minor shirk, it is still greater than the major sins. And the difference is clear. Shirk, even if it is minor shirk, then according to some scholars, it will never be forgiven. But if you were to commit the major sins, then you could still be forgiven in the hereafter. And the mercy of Allah is expansive.